We hope
for love and laughter.
We hope
people will have all they need.
We hope
all can live more fearlessly.
We hope
for an end to pain and misery.
Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength.
Our hope is found in the Spirit of life.
Join me in our mission statement. As followers of Jesus,
we put love first.
In the stillness of night's ashen shadow, just before morning light, when the sun has yet to warm the earth, silhouettes of trees join earth and sky, each stem faintly visible. A solitary bird cries into the dawn. The sound echoes down the river.
There is a quiet of descending stairs leading to my inner self.
A sacred space of serenity where spirit lives in me.
Quiet morning walks awaken beyond conventions, whispering loudly to a sleeping world. Hear these words from the Sufi poet Hafiz. Fear is the cheapest room in the house. I would like to see you live in better conditions. And remember the words of Jesus saying,
the light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you.
Is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death.
Wherever you're joining us from, I invite you to join with me in preparing yourself to enter into this time of meditation and prayer. I like to put my feet solid on the ground. I like to open my palms as a sign of being receptive. But you can fold your hands in prayer. Whatever helps you bracket out this time, wherever it is you find yourself, to be intentionally open to the Spirit. I invite you to close your eyes and take a deep breath with me. Let that out. Settle into wherever it is you are. As we breathe in and breathe out, aware of the irony that the breath we breathe, the breath that sustains us, can also be that which spreads this virus, and that requires us to keep our distance from one another. But knowing too that in so many traditions, the idea of spirit and breath are intertwined. The words for spirit and breath in Hebrew, ruach, and in Greek, pneuma, are used for both spirit and breath. So as we come to this time together, I invite you to breathe in the ruach, the pneuma. Breathe out. Grateful for that sustaining breath that we so often take for granted. That sustaining spirit that we so often take for granted. As we breathe in and breathe out, I invite you to join together with Steve in singing our centering song, words of which you'll find on the screen.
Weave us together, weave us together in unity and love. Weave us together, weave us together, together in love.
I invite you to join with me in our unison act of awareness. Here and now, we gather in separate spaces made sacred by our shared lives and our shared yearnings. May our common bond of commitment to Jesus' teachings stir in us new courage, new generosity of spirit, forgiveness given and received, and rededication to the higher purposes of our lives. Let us not add to the hopelessness that laps at the hearts of many, but seek to beat back despair with gracious action. May perseverance and creativity live in us always, arousing in us a determination to live our lives to the fullest in whatever circumstance we find ourselves. Even now, may we be filled with new passion and new resolve, so that, combined with even the little that we know, we may be guided into wise and compassionate endeavors. What good intentions inspire, may our lives bring to fruition. This is our prayer. And as we come together virtually, bridging the distance through the wonder of technology, may we also sense the wonder and the awe of being connected through the Spirit in ways that continue to be difficult to describe, but undeniable in its effect and in its experience. So that as we make our way through the coming days and weeks and months, that we can continue to stay connected with one another in creative ways, in intentional ways, so that as we move through the various waves of feelings and emotions, feelings of anxiety or fear, feelings of isolation and loneliness, feelings of frustration and uncertainty, may they be tempered by moments of appreciation for those who we are able to reach out to and those who reach out to us by phone, by letter, through emails, through FaceTime, through all the ways that we are quickly becoming more and more at ease with and familiar with. May these moments be times when what may have been previously cold or distant interchanges carry with them more and more of the genuineness and the presentness of our intentions to be with one another in spirit, to be there for one another in encouragement and in compassionate acts that are able to maintain our ability to stay healthy. As we come together all around the world, we're aware on a daily basis, almost moment to moment, of the rapid change of circumstances of so many, of the struggles of our leaders, our first responders, of our doctors and our nurses and our scientists, of those whose work requires of them to be present, and for those whose work has required them to be laid off or to no longer be employed in a way that sustains their lives and their families. There are so many different needs in the world this day. From health to daily sustenance to resources to maintain our living accommodations. For those struggling to keep businesses open, schools operating, children safe, the elderly, and those with underlying conditions well. We pause in this moment to keep in mind that the Spirit works in us every day, and we open ourselves to the way the Spirit is moving us away from fear and anxiety and apathy to remind us the call that Jesus has placed on our lives to be people of transformation, to be people of reconciliation, to be be people of faith. Who've been touched by a spirit, by the kind of grace that inspires us to want to be present to others. So with those aspirations in mind, with that vision for a church that has indeed left the building, a church that has been cast into so many different forms around the world, that we might find our way to be a part of touching those in need in ways that sustain them, sustain us, and are a powerful witness for who we are and our values and commitments as followers of Jesus. We pause now for a moment of intentional quiet, that we might still the chatter in our minds, set aside all of the angst and the worries, so we might simply breathe and be present to this moment where we know the Spirit is at work here and now, wherever here is and wherever now is. We offer this time of quiet openness. We bring our whole selves as we join together in sharing the prayer that Jesus taught his first followers. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For a mission moment this morning, I just wanted to share with you about our interfaith food drive for Extended Hands, our very own local food bank here in Fountain Hills. As many of you know, during the pandemic, their normal level of donations have seen a steep decline, while at the same time, they're experiencing a sharp increase in demand from our neighbors who are experiencing food insecurity. So the Fountains, along with the Fountain Hills Interfaith Alliance, is encouraging you to join with your neighbors from all the different congregations and faith groups in town to contribute much-needed non-perishable food donations for our neighbors through Extended Hands Food Bank. We're going to expedite that effort by inviting you to drop off your donations this coming Friday, April 3rd, from 10 a.m. until 3 p.m. right at the Fountains. There'll be a drive-up location where you can leave your donations while maintaining safe physical distancing. Volunteers will then load your items and transport them to extended hands. If you're a seasonal resident and are returning home early, please consider donating your remaining pantry items to this effort. In the end, it doesn't matter if you're part of a faith community or not. It's important for all of us to pull together and contribute towards supporting this vital local support for our neighbors right here in Fountain Hills. Extended Hands and our participation in it is something that makes me really proud, and I hope it does you too.
Hey guys and gals, welcome to Culprit Enterprises. I thought I'd do something a little different today. This is my humble studio. It's not much, but don't laugh, it's paid for. So anyway, what I did is I laid a drum groove and a bass part and some background vocals, thanks to Jamie, and organ and stuff. It's not as good as the real thing, but it is virus-free because I don't take my music computer on the internet. Haha, little joke there. Anyway, this song's called Lean On Me, and I mean that figuratively, not literally at this point.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend.
Alright, Fountains family out there, please join me and sing it like you mean it.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He has given Jesus Christ the Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ the Son. Give thanks.
Good morning. If you've got your Bible with you at home, I encourage you to open it to 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 24. Before we hear Bruce read it for us this morning, I'd like to give you a little background on the letter and its context. 1 Thessalonians has a couple of things that I really like. The first one is that scholars agree that 1 Thessalonians is one of the seven authentic letters of Paul. Not like the other ones, Ephesians and even 2 Thessalonians, which are not the original Paul. The second thing is that 1 Thessalonians is probably the earliest of all of Paul's writings. So seeing that Paul was our first author of the New Testament, writing long before even the Gospels were written, that means that what we're about to hear is from some of the earliest writings in the New Testament, maybe even as early as the 50s. It was written to the church that Paul had planted in Thessaloniki, which was then the capital of the Roman province of Macedonia, or Macedonia. There's disagreement on how to pronounce it. It was home at that time to, if you can imagine, over 200,000 people. It was central to religions honoring Dionysus and Orpheus, both of which were mystery fertility cults, and the emperor cult. So it was a very prestigious kind of place. It was as cosmopolitan a place as you could even imagine back then. It was both a seaport, and it was right on Rome's major east-west highway called the Egnatian Way. Paul knew going there that there would be huge potential for lots of converts, but at the same time, there was lots of opposition as well. It was hard for the Neophyte Christians there to maintain their identity among all the other options that people had in the city, all the pressure on them to do different things. So once Paul had left, let them go on their own for a while, and then he sent Timothy back to check in on them. Timothy came back to Paul and gave him a report. And so what 1 Thessalonians is Paul writing back to the Thessalonians with some observations, with some encouragement, and some advice on how to live a life as a follower of Jesus.
1 Thessalonians 5:16-24. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit, do not despise the words of the prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good, abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Let's pray. Loving and gracious Spirit, we're grateful for these words of wisdom that come to us from so long ago, from so early on in the experiment of what it meant to be a follower of Jesus. So as we consider these words from Paul to the Thessalonians, may our hearts and minds be open to the Spirit's guidance so that we too might hear these words with fresh and eager ears and hearts, so that none of us would go away from this time together unchanged. We gather as followers of Jesus. Amen. Well, as we continue to face the developing challenges of this global pandemic, there are real emergencies in our healthcare system. There are real tragedies. There's real anxiety. There are real fears. And in the middle of it all, here we are reading a passage in the Bible that sounds almost Pollyannish. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. What? I mean, you've got to be kidding, right? Well, no, I'm not, and neither was Paul. He was writing to a gathering of people who were struggling with how to be followers of Jesus in the midst of difficult times. Their livelihoods were threatened. Their place in society was threatened. And in some cases, their very lives were even threatened. And here we have Paul telling these same Thessalonians that every moment of a life lived with the Holy Spirit is filled with promise and possibility. Be joyful, he says. Be prayerful. Be thankful, no matter what the circumstances. And it's hard to comprehend that making any sense in light of what's going on around us right now, especially if you interpret some of the things that Paul calls for in this passage in a superficial way. So I wanted to look at some of these admonitions and see what they really mean. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances. So the first one, rejoice always. I mean, seriously? First off, the rejoice Paul is talking about here has very little to do with what you might be thinking is of like the kind of spontaneous or carefree happiness. Joy, as far as Paul is concerned, is not something that can be forced or that just erupts the spur of the moment. In fact, the root of the Greek word that is translated here as rejoice, kairo, literally means to be conscious of grace. In other words, it's an awareness of the profound gift that is life. For me, the demands and expectations of everyday life pretty much seem to conspire against this awareness for me, happening on a very regular basis. I really have to work at it. And if you're at all familiar with the Buddhist idea of mindfulness, you might see a parallel here. Be mindful of and marvel at this gift of life we share. So I think that the rejoice that Paul is talking about here is a kind of studied an ongoing condition, a thoughtful way of being that today might be better understood as a profound sense of being grounded in reality and present to every moment. Which then makes it an easy jump to Paul's next piece of advice, which is to pray without ceasing. Now, let me be clear, Paul is not telling the Thessalonians that they should be continually engaged in prayer, folding their hands and kneeling and reciting rote prayers. The Greek word here that's translated as without ceasing, adileptos, sorry for butchering that pronunciation, means incessantly. It means constantly. And it's interesting, it's only used four times in the whole of the New Testament, and three of those four times are right here in 1 Thessalonians. The other two times, Paul is basically telling them that he constantly, or incessantly, or without ceasing, keeps in his mind the Thessalonians' labors of love. And the second time he uses it is constantly or incessantly or without ceasing, giving thanks to God that they are living out the word that they have heard. And so when are they laboring in love and living out the word that they've heard and praying unceasingly? Paul says very clearly that it's in the midst of their tribulation and suffering. So if you know the context, you know that they're not setting aside a fixed time to engage in some sort of formal prayer. Their whole lives are prayer. That's what Paul is encouraging them to strive for. So I think Paul is suggesting what Bishop Jack Spong advocates regarding prayer, which is living a life with a heightened awareness of the spiritual aspects of every action, of every decision. So what Paul is referring to as rejoicing and praying always in his day and time might just as well be described for us today as being mindful of the gift of life, even with all of its trials, and living with a heightened awareness of the spiritual aspects of the everyday. I think it's only then that verse 18 makes any sense, which is give thanks in all circumstances. It doesn't say give thanks for all circumstances, it says in all circumstances. And I wonder if even this sounded pretty pie in the sky to the struggling Thessalonian community, just as it might sound on first hearing to us. But Paul continues on and cautions them to not quench the Spirit, to not put the kibosh on the Spirit. He reminds them that this is the same attitude that Jesus himself embodied and intended for all of his followers. Jesus took advantage of every circumstance to demonstrate the presence of the Spirit. Dom Crossan goes so far as to say that Jesus was God intoxicated, that in every moment he was open to and being influenced by the transcendence of the Spirit. And think about all the stories about his endurance in life. Those fruitless fishing expeditions, having to tolerate the lunkheads that we know as the disciples, suffering the disapproval of the authorities of his day, being confronted by the tragic deaths of both friends and strangers, and enduring the hours before his own arrest and execution. Each and every one of those moments were times that were ripe for Jesus to be open to and demonstrate the presence of, call it what you will, the divine, the Spirit, grace, compassion, and not just to comfort himself, but to turn the world around. Jesus stood in the midst of the common, everyday crises and questions that people have faced for time immemorial, and he didn't ask why. He didn't seek to place blame. He didn't retreat into a posture of self-preservation or apathy. He turned every crisis into an opportunity to show generosity, caring, compassion, and grace. So following Paul's advice to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and to give thanks in all circumstances may, at first glance, seem superficial and might even seem almost heartless when considering the reality of the pain and anxiety and the crises that life can dole out. But our call as followers of Jesus is to strive to turn even the worst of circumstances into opportunities to show generosity, caring, and grace. And to make the implicit explicit, let me be clear on what Paul is taking for granted that the Thessalonians already know, and that I'm taking for granted that you already know. And that is that each of us has the strength and the wisdom within us to do these things. Grounded in reality, and mindful of the Spirit's presence in all things, even flawed, imperfect, and struggling people like you and like me need to remember the words of George Eliot, aka Marianne Evans, and our stream of thought for today. The important work of moving the world forward does not wait to be done by perfect people. Whenever you walk into the sanctuary at the fountains, it is really hard to miss all of the amazing stained glass. Each window in the church has its own story. And the striking rose window at the fountains, as stunningly beautiful as it is in the morning light, has its origin in the kind of tragedy that none of us would want to face. Years ago, it was donated by Richard and Denise Monks following the death of their 5-year-old daughter, Mackenzie, from cancer. And rather than become paralyzed by grief, the family not only donated the funds for the fountain's windows, but they channeled their energy into providing what is now over 3,500 wheeled suitcases filled with toys and comfort items to give to children who are undergoing cancer treatments at various centers around the valley. And to top it off, the Mackenzie Monks Foundation has also donated $1 million to open the Kenzie Center at Phoenix Children's Hospital Center for Cancer and Blood Disorder. The Monks family took a tragedy of the first order and made it an opportunity to be compassionate to others. It's not about being perfect. It's not about being in a good place to do the work. It's about striving to be aware of each moment, no matter the circumstance, being an opportunity that is charged with transcendence. Orson Scott Marden was one of the early proponents of what is now called the New Thought Movement, and perhaps even more memorable than his amazing mustache is his charge to all of us. Don't wait for extraordinary opportunities. Seize common occasions and make them great. Weak people wait for opportunities. Strong people make opportunities. Well, we have moved right past common occasion and are in the midst of the extraordinary. Extraordinary, unprecedented calamity. So, it's time to stop fretting over the why of the tragedies in life, to stop being paralyzed by our anxiety or overwhelmed by waiting for the other shoe to drop. It's time to rejoice always, to pray without ceasing, and to give thanks in all circumstances. Pay attention to the presence of the Spirit. Listen a little more intently. And practice an awareness of the grace that empowers us at all times in every circumstance. Maybe then we can be a part of demonstrating grace, bringing comfort to the afflicted, and moving the world forward towards reconciliation, healing, and hope. Be well.
Comfort ever flowing, call for song.
of highest praise. May I find the strength within me. May I sense it everywhere as I face what must be handled. May I find truth I can share. Of all our living, may our hearts be filled with grace. Streams of goodness ever flowing, call for songs of highest praise. May we seek and find encouragement, may our choices worthy be. Journey on together, may we know integrity.
Jesus lived to show us the way.
Let us follow.
Encouraging one another.
Showing compassion.
Empowered by the Spirit.
Let us follow.
Amen.
Please join us in our sung benediction.
Shalom to you now. Shalom, my friends. May God's full mercies bless you, my friends. In all your living and through your Christ be your shalom. Christ be your shalom.